الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواجه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ويل لكل همزة لمزة الذي جمع مالا وعدده يحسب أن ماله أخلده كلا لينبذن في الحطمة. صدق الله العظيم. There are few punishments in Quran mentioned in Quran al-Kareem for which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the word wail. Wail means destruction. And when it refers to sins and akhirah, it refers to a special kind of destruction. And that is, as explained in a hadith by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was asked, "What is wail, Ya Rasulullah?" It's a word of Arabic language which means destruction. But when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked, "Ya Rasulullah, for certain sins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wail for those people." What does this refer to? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Wadin fi jahannam." This is a valley in the hellfire. The hellfire itself seeks Allah's refuge from that valley every day. It's such a destructive place. A place where all the pus of the people of the hellfire will get together. That is the place that is named Wail. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for certain sins, He says, people who would commit these sins, they will go into Wail, into that special kind of destruction, which means one of the worst punishments of Jahannam. Jahannam itself is the worst punishment, regardless of where the person is in Jahannam. And this place is the worst place, one of the worst places of Jahannam. And one of these sins for which this punishment of wail is mentioned in Quran is وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. That wail, that destruction would be for every slanderer, backbiter. Humaza and Lumaza, mainly they refer to a person, a word called Namima. A person who narrates the talks of one person to another, as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself explained, that he narrates the talk of one person to another ala wajh al-ifsad, to create animosity between the two, to make the two people go against each other. This is called namima in Arabic language. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was passing by two graves, and the hadith is in Sahih al-Bukhari narrated by Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhu, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّهُمَا لَيُعَذَّبَانِ. Both of these people are going through adab in their qabr. May Allah protect us. Both of these people are being punished in their grave. وَمَا يُعَذَّبَانِ فِي كَبِيرٍ. And they are not being punished for something that normally people consider to be a major sin. بَلَا إِنَّهُ لَكَبِيرٌ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, but in reality, both of these sins are major sins. is not something that normally people consider to be something very major. بَلَا إِنَّهُ لَكَبِيرٌ. In reality, they are very major sins. One of them is being punished because of not cleaning himself properly after urinating. So maybe drops of urine remains on his body, on his clothes. And of course, this means when the person is careless about it, and as it was the tradition normal in those days, that they are standing up and urinating, and it splashes back on the person. Or right, as we see these days too, right after the person finished, just walks out without cleaning, without washing, nothing. And of course, by this, for sure, there will be najasa on his body and his clothing. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, one of them is being punished because of this. وَأَمَّا الْآخَرُ فَكَانَ يَمْشِي بِالنَّمِيمَةِ. The other person had the habit of namima, which means raiding things from here and there. Taking things from here, telling these people, then hearing it from these people, they're going to the other home and raiding it over there. And as hadith clearly indicate also that this disease of namima is mostly amongst women. Of course, doesn't mean it's only there, but to great extent, these habits do exist there. This habit of namima, that keep on saying things about people from here and there, whether it's true or not. Tell these people that, you know, when I was there, these people were saying this about you, about these people, about your community, about your masjid. And of course, naturally, this person is going to say something. After hearing this, now go over there and tell those people that those people over there, they were saying this about you. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in one of the hadith says, a person who has this habit, la yadkhulul jannah, will not allowed in Jannah. That person will not be allowed in Jannah. There's such a major sin that could prevent the person from going to Jannah. In a hadith narrated by Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal rahimahullah in his Musnad, on the authority of Abdurrahman ibn Ghanm radiyallahu anhu, he says, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خِيَارُ عِبَادِ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ إِذَا رُؤُوا ذُكْرَ اللَّهِ. The best human beings, the best servants of Allah, خِيَارُ عِبَادِ اللَّهِ, the best servants of Allah are those, when you see them, you remember Allah. You sit with them, you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَشِرَارُ عِبَادِ اللَّهِ. And the worst servants of Allah. Look at the wordings. شِرَارُ عِبَادِ اللَّهِ. The worst servants of Allah are those الْمَشَّاءُونَ بِالنَّمِيمَةِ. Those who have the habit of namima, raging talks from here to there. Just imagine when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us the best and the worst people of this ummah. We have our own imagination of best and people and bad people. But the hadiths are very clear. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam very openly says, شِرَارُ عِبَادِ اللَّهِ. These are the worst people, worst servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who have this habit of narrating heresies and talks from here to there. And not necessarily because it's a lie. If it is a lie, it has its own sin. If it is a buhtan, it has its own sin. But these people are narrating it so that they would insult others, that will make these people dislike each other. And this is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the same hadith says, Al-Mufarriquna bayna al-Ahibba. Those who love to create animosity between people who like each other. Because of their words, because of what they have been telling people, people start disliking each other. These are the worst people. And really we have to look at our own souls and people around us. If our own children, they come home and they start telling us about others by which we disliking people, we have to judge them according to the hadith, not according to our love for our children. Oh, my son came after a long time and he's very nice. He doesn't lie. My daughter came, mashallah, she doesn't lie. And maybe she's the worst liar. But parents' love doesn't allow us to think right. I'm telling you the truth. You always see it. And in this part of the world, with all the wonders that you have, this is another wonder. I have always seen in our childhood that whenever someone would come and tell our parents anything, that I think your son may be doing this, and they would take it, okay, I have to fix it. Whether he's doing it or not, now I have to fix it up. Even if that person may tell them that, look, it's not confirmed, I'm not too sure, right? Okay, that's it. You think that? Okay, that's enough. And now parents will start working on the children. And here, tell the people, I have seen this person doing this. Oh, my child doesn't do this. He's never like this. This is totally two opposite reactions that we see in two different parts of the world. And the main reason behind it is tarbiyah. The way we raise our children, we never cared about their akhlaq. We cared about their education. If someone would scare us about their grades, their education, that's something that would worry us. But if someone tells us anything about their akhlaq, it does not worry us. So when these children bring backbiting at home, they come home and they start backbiting. When they come home and they start slandering and start talking against others and they start just getting into loose talk, not only that, we don't stop them, we enjoy hearing it from them. We approve it. We encourage it. And we say a few more words about that situation that will make them feel, look, my parents really like to hear this. So if I tell them more, they will enjoy even more. Now children, to make their parents enjoy it, they start making up things too. And we are part of that. And as much sin as they are getting, we are getting the same amount of sin, or maybe even worse, because we are just encouraging our children for it. The reason Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us these things so openly, so that we look at ourselves, we look at around us, at our people that we sit with. Make sure that, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, إِنَّمَا أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَأَوْلَادُكُمْ فِتْنَةً. Your wealth and your children could be a fitna for you. And they become the worst fitnas of time. If really, if the fitna comes from that, that's it. You see how people are just getting destroyed. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses a person to make the good use of wealth and blesses a person with good children and good family, that will be the greatest ni'mah. So it could be a great ni'mah, it could be a great fitna. If we see these hobbits there, talking about people, writing sayings about of others, where we start disliking people. Oh yes, my daughter told me this and I think that's right. When a person sees that because of his own people, he's disliking others, because what people, our own people are telling us, we start disliking others, then we have to realize this is something that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has warned us of. And we have to fix the situation. We have to stop it. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes to his own home. Zainab radiallahu anha, she said something against Safiya radiallahu anha. And of course, the intention was that if I would say this about her, then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would be upset with her. That is the same thing as we are reading here, that making one person dislike another person. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was so upset. Now, this is from his own wife. He was so upset. For 2 months, he did not talk to Zainab radiallahu anha. This is how he is treating it at his own home. 2 months, he did not talk to Zainab radiallahu anha, that how could you say something like this about Safiya? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he went for Mi'raj, the hadith is narrated in Sunan Abi Dawood, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَرَرْتُ بِقَوْمٍ لَهُمْ أَصْفَارٌ مِّن نُحَاسٍ. I saw some people who had copper nails. Their nails are out of copper. And يَخْمِشُونَ وُجُوهَهُمْ وَصُدُورَهُمْ. They were scratching their own faces and their chest. I asked Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, من هؤلاء يا جبريل? Jibreel, who are these people? Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam said, هؤلاء الذين يأكلون لحوم الناس ويقعون في أعراضهم. These are the people who used to eat people's flesh through backbiting them. These are the people who used to eat people's flesh and ويقعون في أعراضهم, and they used to dishonor people, talk against people's against people, to dishonor them in the presence of others. This is the punishment that these people would go through from the time they are birthed until the day of Qiyamah. We see that this is one of the main causes of Adab al-Qabr. Ghibah and Namimah. Backbiting and narrating the talk from here and there. These two things are main causes for Adab al-Qabr. And that is something that if a person doesn't even want to take any chance with Adab al-Qabr. Wallahu alam how long it will last. But as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Qabr is the first step towards Akhirah. If a person would not be able to make it there, most probably he will not make it after Hisab. If the Azab will stand in the Qabr, in his grave, then most probably this person will not make it to Jannah. He will have to go through the other way. And one of the main causes of Azab al-Qabr is Ghibah and Namimah. We see the hadith of Sahih al-Bukhari, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this person is being punished only because of namimah, because of narrating talks here and there. And this hadith, which is in Sunan Abi Dawood, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was shown on the night of Mi'raj, that this person, these people, were scratching their bodies with copper nails. Subhanallah, it's a little itchy, and we have to scratch with our regular nails. After some time, you start bleeding. And then how painful it is to scratch anymore. And these are copper nails where a person is just pulling his flesh off. There is another hadith in Musnad Ahmad. Jabir radiallahu anhu narrates, كُنَّا مَعَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فَارْتَفَعَتْ رِيحٌ مُنْتِنَةٌ. We were with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once, and we had a very bad smell. They smelled something very bad. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked the Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhi wa jama'een, أَتَدْرُونَ مَا هَذِهِ? مَا هَذِهِ الْرِيحِ? Do you know what the smell is from? No, ya Rasulullah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this is the smell from the people who backbite others. Miraculously, they were able to smell it in this world. Imagine what smell that would be where that city of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the whole city had the smell of those people. Because someone is backbiting another person. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, advising his students, he used to say, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمْ أَخَاكُمْ قَارَفَ الذَّمْ فَلَا تَكُونُوا أَعْوَانًا لِلشَّيْطَانِ عَلَيْهِ. What a beautiful advice from the Sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, when a person commits a sin, his people who know about his sin, are into two groups now. One are those who are the helpers of Shaitan, and the others who are helping the angels of Rahmah. Every person has Shaitan with him and has an angel with him. When a person commits the sin, this Shaitan will try to encourage the person to do more and more. And the angel that is with the person keeps on reminding him to get off the sin and repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Out of human beings, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that there are two people, two types of people, and here Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu says that there are people who are awan al-shaytan. They are helper of that shaytan. When they find out about this person's sin, they start cursing at him. They start talking bad about him. They start reminding him, accusing him. These are awan al-shaytan. These are the helpers of shaytan. Shaytan wanted evil. They are increasing the evil. They are making the person do even worse. They are making everyone else talk about this person's evil things. These are awan al-shaytan. The other people, now he says, وَلَكِنْ سَلُ اللَّهَ الْعَافِيَةِ. Ask Allah to protect you against that sin. That person has committed, ask Allah to protect you. Because if not, you may fall into it. Then Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu says, فَإِنَّا أَصْحَابُ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ كُنَّا لَا نَقُولُ فِي أَحَدٍ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى نَعْلَمُ عَلَى مَا يَمُوتُ. It was the habit of Sahaba. He says, I have always seen this akhlaq and this habit of the Sahaba, that whenever we knew something bad about a person, we would not say anything against the person. We would not say anything against the person until when this person would die. If this person would die with Iman, we would know that inshallah he's doing good. And if this person, God forbid, he dies without Iman, or at the last days of his life, he dies while committing those sins, then we would know that he may be having a difficult time. But while this person is alive, we would not say anything about this person. This was the habit of Sahaba radhiyallahu anhu. Inshallah, if we get a time, we'll go into the detail of this another topic. But quick reminder, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith, Ad-deenu an-nasiha. This deen is a name of being a well-wisher. SubhanAllah, he's introducing this deen to us. Ad-deenu an-nasiha. This deen is nothing but nasiha. But being a well-wisher. They asked, Ya Rasulullah, nasiha for who? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Lillahi. ولرسوله ولأئمة المسلمين ولعامتهم. نصيحة, well wisher, and looking for good. For who? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, for Allah. For Allah means helping the deen of Allah. ولرسوله, and for his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, following him and establishing his sunnahs. ولأئمة المسلمين, and scholars like Hafiz al-Hajr and others have explained that A'immat al-Muslimin, being a well-wisher for A'immat al-Muslimin, means when a'immatul muslimin, scholars of Islam, when they do anything wrong, we don't talk about it. We don't read the texts talking against them. And I said, it's a lengthy topic where we can see the special position given to a'immatul muslimin in Islam. Of course, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam advised us that three people according to their status. And a'immatul muslimin, the scholars of Islam, there is a special status for them. As Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in another hadith, in which is in Kinzul Umman, that if those people make a mistake and they commit a sin, and who is immune against sins other than Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive them, will increase their status after they repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and a person who talks against them surely will be destroyed. Scholars throughout have said a word, and they used to always advise their students, إِيَّاكُمْ وَالْحُومَ الْعُلَمَاء. This advice you find it in a lot of books. إِيَّاكُمْ وَالْحُومَ الْعُلَمَاء. Always refrain from eating the flesh of ulama. Always refrain from eating the flesh of ulama. Backbiting ulama, talking against ulama. فَإِنَّ الْحُومَ الْعُلَمَاءِ مَسْمُومَةً. Because their flesh will only bring poison into your body. Which means, and as the scholars have really said it a lot of times advising their students, that when you backbite any of the ulama, for sure Allah will punish you for it. That's a poison that is surely going to affect your life. وَلِأَيْمَةَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. نَصِيحَ, being a well-wisher for أَيْمَةَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. And another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam advised that, which means, if a person commits, if you see a'immatul muslimin, did something wrong, sit with the person, talk to the person, remind the person. And same thing, وَلِعَامَّتِهِمْ, for the general public, nasiha for general public, for all Muslims. Of course, special attention to a'immatul muslimin, and then لِعَامَّتِهِمْ, for all Muslims. A person who is not a well-wisher for the Muslims, and he's looking for other Muslims to be suffering, to go through hardship, to go through difficulties, and to be punished, وَلَعَيَازُ بِاللَّهِ, I'm looking forward for Allah to punish this person, this is not this deen. This person belongs to some other deen. Because this deen is only nasiha. This person should realize that he doesn't belong to here. Once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was approached by Ma'iz radiallahu anhu, the Sahabi who committed zina wal'ayyazu billah. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam applied the punishment. Two of the Sahaba radiallahu alayhi wa sallam started talking about him. That look, he was stoned to death like you kill a dog because of this type of sin that he committed. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam overheard them. He didn't say anything at that time. He started going back. On the way, as all the Sahaba are walking behind Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on his way, he sees a dead animal. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called those two Sahaba and he said, eat this animal. Eat this dead animal. He said, Ya Rasulullah, وَمَنْ يَأْكُلُ هَذَا? Who can eat this, Ya Rasulullah? This is a dead animal. It's haram. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what you just did was worse than eating this. The statement that you made about that brother of yours was worse than eating this dead animal. Now just imagine. There is one person, then we see him sitting out there eating haram. On the other hand, we come home, we sit with our family, and pure and halal food. But we both, or all of us, we are feeding our each other that meat, that flesh of our own Muslim brothers. This is what we normally feed each other at our homes. We give each other the flesh of our own brothers and our own sisters. Who is worse of the two? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that that person who's sitting out in the restaurant, maybe eating pork, eating something, is still his better than this person who's sitting at his home with all the virtues that he feels that he carries. But when he's attacking others, when they're sitting and talking against others, and the flesh of dead people that they are, or other, their Muslim brothers and sisters that are feeding each other, these people are worse than those people. How clear the hadith is. That what you did just now was worse than eating this dead animal. Imam Bayhaqi rahimahullah narrates, once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhi wa sallam, Al-ghibatu ashaddu min al-zina. Backbiting is worse than zina. Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhi wa sallam asked, Ya Rasulullah, وكيف الغيبة أشد من الزنا؟ How can backbiting be worse than zina? رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إن الرجل ليزني فيتوب فيتوب الله عليه. A person commits zina, وعياذ بالله, he seeks Allah's forgiveness, he gets the forgiveness. It was a sin between him and Allah سبحانه وتعالى. وإن صاحب الغيبة لا يغفر له حتى يغفرها له صاحبه. And the person who backbites others, Allah will not forgive him until that person will forgive. So this person is stuck now. Until that person will forgive. With that sin, it was between him and Allah. Allah may forgive him. With this sin, Allah have made the ruling that I will not forgive. Once, two Sahaba were discussing about some people who had committed major sins in Islam. This was in the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they are discussing about some people who had committed some major sins in Islam. And of course, the way they were talking about it was, this was so bad of them that they would do something like this. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, advising these sahaba, said, whatever those people did, they may repent to Allah and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive them. And that will become kafara for all of their sins. وَتُحَاسَبُ أَنْتَ بِمَا عَمِلْتَ And you will be judged for your actions. You will be judged for whatever you have done and that person will be judged for his actions. Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu, when they were stoning one of the sahaba who committed that sin, some blood came on his clothing. Khalid radiallahu anhu, of course, he felt very bad that his blood came on my body, on my clothing. So he said, he makes a statement about it. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Khalid, why are you trying to look down at this person? Do you realize, Khalid, that the tawbah he did was such a tawbah? He repented to Allah so strongly and with so sincerity that if that tawbah of this man is distributed to all the people of Medina, everyone will be guaranteed the Jannah. Forgiveness, maghfirah of Allah. He got the time of maghfirah, that if that is distributed to all the people of Medina, everyone will be guaranteed the Jannah by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they all will be forgiven by Allah. Once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was informed that a person is drinking. And there was a person who came into Islam, he was of the habit of drinking before Islam. He was brought to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he asked Sahaba to apply the punishment on him. After some days, again the person is brought back. Same thing. He again told the Sahaba to punish him the same way and he was punished. Few more days and then bring him back. Some of the Sahaba radhiyallahu anhum said, how bad this person is. Every few days he's doing the same thing over and over. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا تكونوا أعوان للشيطان على أخيكم. Don't be the helpers of shaitan against your brother. Make dua for him. Don't be the helper of shaitan against your brother. Again, a'wan al-shaytan. There are people from amongst people that are the helpers of shaitan when someone will do something wrong. He said, don't be the helpers of shaitan. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and of course, he knew the person. He knew what's in this person's heart. He's a prophet of Allah. He says, إِنَّهُ يُحِبُّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ. This person loves Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So don't say anything against him. I see the love of Allah and His Messenger in this person's heart. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the right understanding of our being. It is really deep. It is really different than what we normally look at. It is really different than what we normally understand of this deen, the reality of this deen to be. It is much different than that. These ahadith are extremely important that we repeatedly mention these ahadith to our souls, mention it to our families. Maybe that these type of hadith, we need a copy of it on our dining table when we sit together, so that we don't feed each other the flesh of our own brothers and sisters. Refraining from all the other haram, working so hard to stay away from haram ingredients, checking the ingredients and all of this, and this is mushtaba, and throw this out in the garbage, and here, open haram, and we are feeding it each other. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to Sirat al-Mustaqeem and protect all of us from all kind of azab, azab al-dunya, azab in our graves, and protect us from azab of the akhirah. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين. And by the way, before we just go, a quick reminder, tomorrow is the last Jum'ah, which means starting from this Maghrib, this is the last Jum'ah of Ramadan. And not because of being last, but because of being the last opportunity for us to have Jum'ah in Ramadan. We should try to make the best use of it, inshallah. The 27th night of Ramadan at the same time. So it's the 27th night of Ramadan, which has the possibility, not for sure, but has the possibility of being Laylatul Qadr. And then, of course, night of Jum'ah. And last opportunity of having Jum'ah in Ramadan. We should try to make the best use of our time, at least make it the best day of our life if possible, if we can, and whatever we can. And especially, as much as we can, sending durood and blessings on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because this will be the greatest ibadah for us, for our life, for this day, for Ramadan, and you just name it. It's this day, the day that we are entering it now, it's just full of virtues. Jum'ah has its own virtues that other days do not. Then having Jum'ah in Ramadan, then being on the 27th night of Ramadan, and then having it as a last opportunity this Ramadan, wallahu a'lam, what happens next Ramadan. So, inshallah, let's try to make the best use of it and use it in the best way we can, especially, as I said, sending blessings on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And of course, a lot of istighfar, because Allahumma innaka afoon tuhibbul afwa fa'afu anni is a teaching from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that Laylatul Qadr is a night for istighfar, for getting the forgiveness, afu of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that is another very important ibadah. And as of course we are towards the end of Ramadan, we don't want this month to run out without we all getting the total and full forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept us and give us tawfiq. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله.